Yesterday I talked about this example and the main theorem that classifies for all these cobordism categories. It classifies functors from them into groupoids, or more precisely, it translates that question to a homotopy theoretic question, which a priori is often easier. I mentioned this example, finite subsets of R and one-dimensional cobordisms in R across an interval. The upshot is the fundamental groupoid of loops of RP2. It's easy to see that's equivalent to a two-object groupoid where both automorphism groups are Z. So that tells you that functors out of this category are uniquely determined up to isomorphism by specifying two objects and one automorphism of each object, satisfying nothing. There was a question about what is this isomorphism? and there were some typos, or whatever you want to call it, in the problem set, but the two objects you can take to be the empty set and the one-point set, and the two automorphisms can be a circle and a circle with like a line under it. okay, so today I'll try to get a little bit closer to what other people call field theories, namely symmetric monoidal functors. Into some symmetric monoidal category. Cob D or variants. Let me remind you what symmetric monoidal category means, or not in all detail, but at least so it's, as all definitions, there's some data and there's some conditions on that data. Let me tell you what all the data is, and then not all the conditions. Symmetric monoidal structure on Cob D. Symmetric monoidal unfortunately sounds like an adjective, as if it's a property or something. But the symmetric monoidal structure is extra structure. It consists of an object, which in this case is the empty D minus one manifold in Cob D. Then it consists of a functor from the category cross itself back to the category. In this case, it's disjoint union of closed D minus one manifolds and disjoint union of D-dimensional cobordisms between them. then it's three natural isomorphisms. There's one natural transformations goes between functors. You can take disjoint union M0 disjoint union M1 disjoint union M2, or you could put the parentheses the other way. And the same for morphisms. That's two functors, and they're kind of obviously naturally isomorphic. That's a preferred way of identifying these. Whoops, these two ways of putting the parentheses. They're likely not equal. Depends a little bit on how you implement things on the set level. Another natural isomorphism. Cob D cross Cob D. D. If you take disjoint union in this way, it's canonically isomorphic to taking disjoint union in the other way, both on objects and morphisms. And the last natural isomorphism goes from M to Z disjoint union M. Whoops, this is one of the functors. Cob D. Cob D. you can take disjoint union with the M to Z, and then you could just take the identity. They're naturally isomorphic, and that's a preferred natural isomorphism. So that's the structure you have to specify to say that cob D is a symmetric monoidal category. And then the, what, four axioms. The most famous one maybe is called the pentagon axiom. Let me not write them. So that's how it's a symmetric monoidal category. Then topological field theory is at least one definition is that it's a symmetric monoidal functor into vector spaces or maybe modules. So if you have a commutative ring, there's a symmetric monoidal structure on the category of modules. Specify the same data. The object you specify is just R itself. By the way, these all have names. This is called the monoidal unit. Maybe I'll put it here. The next piece of data is the tensor product. Called maybe just the tensor or the product or something. It's often considered the most important part of the structure. Then all these natural isomorphisms have named. This one is called the associator, this one is called the symmetry, and this is sometimes called the unitor. This is the standard way of identifying these two things. M0 tensor M1 tensor M2 goes to M0 tensor M1 tensor M2, and so on, associator. The symmetry, M0 tensor M1, M1 tensor M0. I mean, there are other ways to do it. You could try to put some signs in or something, but if you don't say anything else, I think the symmetric monoidal structure you mean here would just be the plain one. And then the unitor is the usual isomorphism from R tensor a module to back to the module. The name here. It's the name for the natural transformation. It's the unit, it makes this the monoidal unit. okay, let me just say one of the axioms in case you haven't seen this before. The pentagon axiom has to do with if you put parentheses this way. There are two ways of identifying it with there's sort of two ways of proving that these are natural isomorphic, and they might not be the same way, or I mean they are, but but in the abstract that's an axiom of this associator, that if you first use the associator to move the parentheses there and then move it again, it's the same as if you do something else you could also do. Yep. So this is an equality of natural isomorphisms. Yeah. Yeah, so for isomorphisms, there's no confusion. They're either equal or not equal. So pentagon axiom is an equality of two natural transformations. Between these two functors, and similarly for the other axioms. Okay, so that's the structure these have. Then symmetric monoidal functor is also extra structure. I mean, it's a functor together with some extra structure. Again, let me just tell you what the data is and skip the axioms. So again, the data is the functor of underlying categories, and then it's a natural isomorphism from the monoidal unit in the codomain, sometimes just denoted one, to Z of one, where one here is empty set. And another natural isomorphism, Z of M0 disjoint union M1, Z of M0 tensor Z of M1. And they're required to satisfy various diagrams after commute that have to do with the associator, the unit store, and the symmetry. I looked at a TS paper this morning, he just writes equal and doesn't like keep track of the isomorphisms, but as far as I could see. Okay, so that's okay, that's the definition, or half part of the definition at least. So you could take D to be R modules, maybe complex numbers, and this tensor product. That would be an R linear. So this would maybe call it devalued. Again, maybe you want to remember the dimensions, d minus 1 comma d, topological field theory, something like that. Such a functor. I don't have anything in this class. We won't talk more about them in this generality, but again, if the if all morphisms go to isomorphisms, or we might as well just say if D is a groupoid, then we can again translate this to some homotopy theory. So the translation we already had to do with spaces and categories, continuous maps and functors. And I didn't emphasize it so much, but here I could also put natural transformations. The corresponding thing to put over here would be homotopies. But it's actually better to say that the corresponding thing is homotopies up to homotopy. So homotopy classes of homotopies between maps. So, so you have a homotopy between two maps. If you have two of them, they can be homotopic rel endpoints of the homotopy. The translation here went, if you have a space, you take fundamental groupoid, get category, and so on. Homotopy class of a homotopy is enough to get a natural transformation. And in the other direction, you take classifying space of the category, and you get this data. A natural transformation actually gives a homotopy, but composition of natural transformation only goes to composition, to concatenation up to homotopy of homotopies. So I think this is the right thing to put here. And if you go back and forth, you always end up in groupoids. Functors and natural isomorphism. Now up here, I could put symmetric monoidal everything. Symmetric monoidal functors. And symmetric monoidal natural transformations, whatever that is. Then there's a forgetful functor here. So what I'll talk about today is what to put here. How do we translate categories with this extra structure to spaces with some other extra structure? So the answer is going to be of the form spaces with something, maps preserving that something, and similarly back and forth here. Well, there's a kind of answer that's easy to give, but somehow doesn't seem to occur very often in nature. What extra structure do you need on a space to inherit a symmetric monoidal structure on the fundamental groupoid? Say, if you don't want to make any choices or anything. So this is answer one. You can just take the axioms of a symmetric monoidal groupoid and just write the same thing over here under this dictionary. The axioms of a symmetric monoidal category of groupoid is something that's expressed in terms of functors, natural transformations, and equality between natural transformations. You just write the same thing over here. So there would be a space X, a point 1 in X, a map from X cross X to X. Maybe let me call it M. homotopy, X cross X cross X. out of this map, I could either take M of X0 comma M of X1 comma X2, or I could take M of X0 comma X1. Then M of that comma X2. Say, name some new kind of structure in a space that is given by a point, a map, a specified homotopy, class of a homotopy. Oh, I erased the axioms of a similar homotopy between X cross X, M of X, 0, X1. That gives a continuous map like this, M of X1, X0, and homotopy of maps from X to X, the one hand identity, and the other one, M of 1, comma X. If you have a space with all this data, and you take fundamental groupoid, you get precisely the data you need for a symmetric monoidal category, like no more, no less. And then you just take all the axioms and phrase them as axioms in terms of this structure. Like the pentagon axiom becomes some axiom. Out of this data, you can extract two different homotopies between maps from X to the 4 to X, and then require them to be homotopic as homotopies, and similarly for the other axioms. Okay, so that's in some sense a complete answer because that allows you to go back and forth here if this is your dictionary. I don't think this structure has a name because it rarely occurs in nature. What occurs is either less or more. That's the notion of an H space, for example. That's a space together with a map. Then there's a notion of a homotopy associative H-space. That's a space together with a map for which such a homotopy exists, but it's not part of the data. Then there's something that's more rigid than this data I wrote here, which also occurs in nature. That's the notion of an EN space. So let me talk about that. And that fits well with the cobordism categories and so on. So to say what an EN space is, again, I'm going to skip a lot of the data. But I first have to talk about little disks. So there's a space called dn of k. It's the space of maps from k copies of the disk into the disk that are embeddings, such that, let's say, they exist ti 0 1 vi in the interior of the disk, so that j of I comma x is vi plus ti x. So embeddings that can be written as embedding from k copies of the disk back into the disk, that can be written as scale by something and shift by something else. Okay. Apologize to the experts in the audience. They might be have heard this before several times. So that's a space, and you can topologize it using this, these. These are, of course, unique if they exist. So they determine J.
So the TIs and VIs satisfy some
positions? No, they're just, this is just a, this is just a space. And they satisfy the condition that if you take this function, then it should be injective. That's all.
Can't the translation take
you? As I said, it's the condition. So. But absolutely, yeah, so this is a proper subspace for that reason. This has the structure of an operat. Let me again say what the data is and not all the conditions. So this is a topological space. Topologize it as a subspace of the Euclidean topology. When we say that these spaces form an operat, k, by the way, is a non-negative integer, we mean that it encodes the action of a symmetric group. Then there are various composition maps. If I have an element in dn of k, I have an element of dn of k prime, and I get a map, an element in dn of k plus k prime minus 1. Composition I, where where this means if I have two embeddings like this, I have okay, let me just say it in words. J and J prime. J circle I J prime. K plus K prime minus 1. Copies of the interior of the disk. you take the k inputs of j, and then you take the output of j prime and plug it into the ith input of j, and that gives you a map like this. And you can write some formulas, but let me not do that. And it's continuous. And then one more piece of data, namely the identity in dn of 1. This is one way of writing the data of an operator. And then there's some properties, of which the most important is associativity. I wrote, okay, J circle I, J prime circle I prime, J double prime is apparently equal to J circle I, J prime circle I plus I prime minus 1, J double prime. And some other properties. That's another associativity property. Then there's one saying that about composing with the identity. And then there's something about how the group action interacts with composition. Not really. I mean, if you know the image of this J, that's what you're saying?
Yeah,
no, that's the same. I mean, I think it's good to think of them as maps from multiple copies of the same object into the same object. But I don't know. So you're pointing out that the image of this thing determines what the map is, because there's only one way of scaling and translating, as long as you know. Well, if you know the image and like the labeling of which disk is the image of which copy. I mean, if you say it with maps, then somehow composition is composition. Otherwise, you can also say it with like plug one picture into the other picture. But yeah, it's easy to go back and forth between those two points of view. So. Okay, more properties. If X is a space, then there's another operator called the endomorphism operator, whose kth space is just the space of maps from X cross with itself k times into X in the compact open topology. And in that case, the ith composition circle I of x1 up to xk plus k prime minus 1 is again, you take the output of f prime and plug it into the ith entry of f. That also satisfies some associativity. And then a DN structure on X is a map from this piece of structure to the other piece of structure. DN structure. X. This is continuous maps. D n k to end x k for all k bigger than or equal to 0, preserving the structure. S k actions. circle I composition and units. One should go to the identity. That's one of these circle I. I can run from one up to the number of inputs of the left vector here. Okay, so that takes a while to say all that, even skipping a bunch of stuff. The main, okay, so the reason I'm saying this is two things. where did my chalk go? Oh, here. Oh, wow, okay, maybe I should have called it DN structure. Okay, so an EN algebra is a space together with an action. Yeah. It also makes sense in other categories. You can talk about EN algebras and so on and so, but in spaces it means a space together with this data. Okay, there's several versions. I talked about little disk. There's also a version with little cubes, where you don't have round things, but boxes. But let's stick to this one. So one thing I wanted to explain is if n is at least 3, there's a, let me say, canonical symmetric monoidal structure on the fundamental groupoid. And by canonical, I mean functorial. As you'll see, there's a choice you have to make, but. And. Yes, for. On this. Yes, exactly, thank you. For, so given EN structure on X is functorial in, okay, I didn't say that, but there's a notion of maps of this structure compatible with all this, and this is going to induce a symmetric monoidal functor. That's one thing. And the other is that for dimension of V being N, the equivalence that I mentioned last time, I call the main theorem, BCDV equivalent to loops V of